आशा एस विजय. वेलकम टू फर्टिलिटी, ऑल अबाउट फर्टिलिटी और ए कप ऑफ टी विद द एक्सपर्ट्स. टुडे वी हैव अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग टॉपिक, इंट्रायूटराइन इंसेमिनेशन, विच इज़ अ वेरी ईजी प्रोसीजर, कॉस्ट इफेक्टिव, पेशेंट फ्रेंडली एंड इट कैन बी डन इन एनी पार्ट ऑफ द वर्ल्ड इन एनी क्लिनिक विद मिनिमम सेटअप. But the most disheartening feature of IUI is it has a very limited success rate, around 10-15%. Out of the 100 people who undergo IUI, only 10-15 people conceive with a procedure with one insemination of intrauterine insemination. So let us find out from the experts here. Dr. Chaitra, our medical assistant medical director of Garbhagudi, and Dr. Sophia, who is the chairperson of the clinical committee. These two doctors are very, very experienced with this procedure of IUI and they have the maximum success rate in their respective units, that is Kalyan Nagar with Dr. Chaitra and Electronic City with Dr. Sophia. When I started this Garbhagudi around 10 years back, people used to come into the clinic and ask me, we have undergone almost 6-8 cycles of IUI and will you do one more cycle of IUI and how are you different? At that time, I had no answers because I had no expertise or no experience. But at this point of time, with so much of experience and so much of expertise and development with the infrastructure happening every year with the Garbhagudi, I know the answers are very easy and it will really satisfy your questioning mind and give you a lot of solution and solace also. Come, let's meet the experts now. Dr. Chaitra, we know IUI is such a simple procedure and we give it to all the patients who come into our clinic with the problem of infertility. But why is that IUI is fraught with so much of limited success rates?
Okay, first of all, ma'am, IUI, as we know that it is a very commonly performed fertility treatment. So anybody who walks into a fertility clinic or an obstetrician gynecologist, usually this is the first treatment which is offered. But we have to understand that not all infertile couple are the one who actually require this treatment. There are couple who actually require higher forms of treatment, but often because most gynecologists can easily offer this treatment, quite often many unsuitable couples are taken into this kind of treatment. So if I have to name few things, first of all, age of the female factor. So if the age should be generally less than 32 for us to have a good success rates, a short married life, say less than 7 years or so, intact tubes. We also have to see that how the semen parameters are, whether the semen parameters are suitable for this kind of IUI treatment. And it's not just about the count and motility of the semen. We also have to look into morphology, which is quite often ignored by most gynecologists. And there are numerous sperm function tests which are available, which is not done by conventional analysis. So we miss out a lot of sperm function tests. So because of all these things, many couples are improperly selected for this treatment and the result, we have a very limited success rates. So to have a good success rates, what we call in IVF around 15-20%, it's very important that we choose the right couple.
Dr. Sophia, I've always seen that you have the exceptional success rates with your IUI procedures. And I also see that gynecologists, they stimulate the couples in their clinics and they send for this IUI processing or a semen washing to distant places. Will this affect the success rates?
Definitely, ma'am. As per many of the studies, it's proven now that after the semen sample is prepared, it should be inseminated within half an hour of preparation. If it's going to take more than half an hour, then obviously the result will not be that good. And also the mode of transportation, with temperature, how we are carrying, all this will affect the success rate. So we always encourage the outside doctors to come to Garbhagudi and to perform the IUI procedure, even if they want the processing to be done in Garbhagudi.
Okay, what about the quality of the labs?
Definitely, ma'am. The culture conditions, the quality, air conditions, how neat and clean and how is the air quality in the lab, it all affects the success rate. And most importantly, the person who is preparing the semen sample, not all lab persons will be trained to do an IUI processing. There are different ways of doing a semen preparation. They should be knowing what semen parameters, what type of technique should be chosen for the preparation of the IUI.
And one point I have to add that quite often a normal ejaculate, like an ormozoospermic patients, because of improper training to the technicians, they actually spoil the semen sample which will be inseminated. So definitely training and a proper technician who is trained in this kind of processing techniques are very crucial for an IUI success.
It's such an important feedback, because I know, I remember in my clinic, once a wash sample came into my clinic, I just put a drop of it under the microscope. Everything was dead.
It will be quite often bad than the, actually the ejaculate sample is.
Exactly.
So it's important that we do the processing from the right person who is trained under this.
Yeah. And what are the reasons by which the IUI can be failing repeatedly? Commonest.
One is, ma'am, as I said, age is one factor where the quality of eggs which are ovulated may not be of a good thing. And maybe they might have done a tubal assessment in the form of HSG. But quite often we miss this stage 1, 2, 3 endometriosis where the tubo-ovarian relation may not be maintained at all. And other things are that we only concentrate on count motility, ignoring the other sperm function tests. And there could be undiagnosed genital tuberculosis or a long, because there is a long-standing infertility itself is telling that there might be a deeper issues into the gametes. Okay. So all these things has to be taken into consideration when we counsel a patient about the success rates.
Okay. Do you want to add anything, doctor? Presence of a fibroid, polyps.
Guess what? To understand the success rate of IUI, we should just go back to the fundamentals that how pregnancy occurs. So for a normal for a successful pregnancy to happen, from the female side, we require a functional normal tube, a good an open patent and a functional tubes, and the first is the uterus, then the tubes and the ovaries. All these three should be normal. And from the male side, we have the semen parameters. So coming to the uterus, we have to rule out any kind of polyps, fibroid, or recurrent thin endometrium, or as she said, genital tuberculosis. We have to rule out. Then coming to the tube has to be open as well as normal and functioning. So many a times when we do a tube test with HSG, we just know that a tube is open or blocked. We don't know whether tube is stuck, whether tube is functional or not, we don't know. Which we get to know when we do our diagnostic hysterolaparoscopy. Then we have the ovarian factor, wherein we get to know the whether the egg is growing properly or not, whether she's ovulating or not. So all these three parameters, organs should be functioning well, plus the semen factors has to be taken into consideration.
And one more thing is that we also have to look into our stimulation protocols. Yeah. So this is something where patients just see that, okay, she ovulated, sperm was inseminated, she has to succeed. We have to look into a proper stimulation protocol, and then the egg is triggered for ovulation at the right time. Whether it is doing prematurely or egg is quite post-mature and all at that stage may not help. And the timing of IUI. Many a times we trigger ovulation, we just call the patient after 36 hours, whereas she might have prematurely ovulated much prior. And we know that the egg will be alive only for 12 to 24 hours. So we might be missing this crucial time where the egg was active and performing an IUI much later. So all these things we have to look into this when we are performing an IUI.
And also one thing which I have noticed is many doctors from usual gynecologist, they will start with the ovulation induction medicines of CCQ or letrozole without doing a day 2 or day 3 scan. They'll give the medicine without doing any scan and directly call the patient on day 10 or day 12 to see for the follicular growth. But it's very, very important that we do a baseline scan on day 2 or day 3 before starting the medication to rule out whether she's having any pre-existing cyst. Because when we do, when the patient is having a cyst and we stimulate them with the medication, later part of the cycle, we will not be able to differentiate whether it was a cyst or a growing follicle. So that is also another reason why IUI doesn't work out with them.
Correct. Most of the patients know, they refuse this day 2, day 3 scans. They want the medicines to be put on WhatsApp or through a phone call. And then they'll directly go on day 2. Yes. So you're telling them it's wrong way of starting their IUI stimulation. Thank you, doctor. If a patient comes with repeated IUI failure, how do you proceed, doctor, for them to get more success in this cycle?
We have to look into deeper tests, ma'am, whether the patient was ovulating properly, how was her endometrium at that time, whether we have missed her, like all this what Dr. Sophia was telling, uterine factors or a tubal factors. So overall evaluation from the female point of view includes this pelvic ultrasound to rule out any polyps or adenomyosis and all. And then any in coming to the tube test, if you are still want to continue with a UI treatment only, best is to assess by a diagnostic hysterolaparoscopy to see that the tubes are actually functioning, not just open. And then a proper stimulation protocol, IUI timing, all those things. And again, coming to the male factor, we have to get into the other sperm function test, say doing a DNA fragmentation index to see whether, although they are normozoospermic or mild borderline semen parameters, whether they actually suit this treatment.
So what should be the normal DFN?
It should be more less than 25%. Ideally, for a normal people, it is less than 15. 15 to 25% range, they can still try for IUIs. But something more than 25, definitely the chances of success in IUI is very less and the abortion risk will also be high. So best to opt for IVF in such a case.
So your message to the common people is, if they're having repeated IUI failures, they better check their DFI and go ahead with one more cycle of IUI.
Yeah, if it's normal, yeah, go ahead. Otherwise, it's best to stop.
Okay. And regarding the laparoscopy, when we counsel a patient for laparoscopy, usually they think it's an invasive procedure. They refuse it outright. Can you just tell us what are the advantages in having one proper diagnostic hysterolaparoscopy?
So ma'am, as I told you, in HSG, which is the X-ray form of testing the tubes, we get to know whether the tube is just open or blocked.
Yeah.
Whereas in a diagnostic hysterolaparoscopy, we get to know whether it's open or blocked. How is the tubal pathology? Whether the tube is it's stuck or it's freely moving. Normal tube should be freely moving because it is supposed to catch the eggs.
Yeah.
If it's open but stuck somewhere and the tube is somewhere and ovary is somewhere, it's not the egg is not going to enter the tubes.
Yeah.
So we get to know the tubal pathology. And most important thing is, if in case we get to know that the tubes are blocked and it's a mild category of blockage, in the same sitting we can remove the blockage. The patient doesn't have to undergo another form of a procedure for the blockage to be removed.
Okay.
So it can be diagnostic as well as therapeutic at the same sitting.
Yeah, and also the presence of endometriotic spots
can be fulgurated.
Yeah, in the same sitting. Yes.
And moreover, in case if any uterine polyps or genital TB is suspected, we can take biopsies, remove the polyps and also rule out endometrial hyperplasias, which is again a cause of failure. And quite often we come across polycystic ovarian patients also, where in case if they are suitable, say where AMH is very high, irregular cycles with high LH on day 2, resistance to ovarian stimulation or induction, then we can combine with ovarian drilling also.
Okay.
So these are some of the advantages. So whenever, especially when the patient is young and wish to try for a long time these sort of treatments, whether it is timed intercourse or an IUI, best is to assess them so that it will be reassuring for those people to continue to try for longer time.
Okay, coming to the polycystic ovarian patient, it becomes so common nowadays. According to your experience and expertise, how do you think we should treat a patient of PCOS with IUI? Is it any different or should we add something else for them?
Mainly is their challenge lies with the ovulation induction.
Yeah.
So they might be resistant or sometimes they might overtly respond, which results in multifollicular response and again resulting in whether it's OHSS or multiple gestation. So it is very important we have a controlled stimulation for these patients targeting only one or two ovarian follicles.
Okay.
And as we discussed in our previous discussions and all, polycystic ovarian patients, there are particular protocols which we follow regarding dosage and timing of their scans and all, which has to be followed.
Dr. Sophia, anything else to do with the patient with PCOS?
Ma'am, that's what we need to find the baseline, that is day 2, day 3 hormones, especially the FSH and LH, because these are the indirect indicators of egg quality. If the FSH-LH ratio is disturbed, then the LH ratio is very high, if the LH value is very high, then the egg quality may not be good. Such patients will, doing a diagnostic hysterolaparoscopy with ovarian drilling will help in them. So we need to assess their hormonal values check the AMH, and also if we get to know their previous response to the stimulation, we also get to get a rough idea that how we should be stimulating her in this cycle.
Okay.
If she's faced ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome in the previous cycle with just 50 dose of CCQ, then this cycle I may not give the same dose. I'll decrease it. And also we get to know if, in case if she's had a resistance, she's required multiple dosages of injections in the previous cycle and yet she didn't have any dominant follicle. Such patients, it's better to go to ovarian drilling and then decrease the hormone and take over.
Okay. And one point I think even Dr. Sophia is aware, so many gynecologists keep calling us during their ovarian stimulation that the patient has having a follicular stalling or not responding. So why? Because day to FSH LH, quite often they are not undergoing such tests. So probably when they started stimulation, their LH value was very high. So it may not, they may not respond to any sort of stimulation.
Okay.
So it's important that polycystic ovarian patients do have their day to FSH LH done.
Okay. And any sort of adjuvant treatment will help them in...
So as I said, ma'am, in case if LH is high, maybe pre-treatment with contraceptive pill or progesterone will help them to bring down their LH levels. And if the patient is obese, making them lose weight and then taking into cycle. Or we can have add adjuvants like inositols or metformin therapies. Dexamethasone
the
also
having
improves
features of hyperandrogenism. Then we can add steroids like Dexona and all, which, you know, in such patients, the response is very good with Dexona.
Okay. And what about tuberculosis, which is a common condition in India? Will this also affect their IUS success rate and how should it be treated?
Definitely. Tuberculosis, in a patient with tuberculosis, we see that it has affinity towards tubes a lot. So many a times we have seen that patients with history of tuberculosis, maybe a pulmonary tuberculosis, the tubes may be invariably affected. So even if the tubes are, let's say, open, it will have that characteristic beaded pattern, sacculations are stuck to each other. So all these things may not result in a successful IUI. So therefore, such patient who has had a history of tuberculosis, it's better to evaluate them with diagnostic hysterolaparoscopy. And then we can proceed depending on the result, whether we have to go for IUI or IVF for them.
But how long will they take for the treatment of TB?
Ma'am, that will depend on the severity.
Okay.
It can
be
6 to 9 months of treatment.
Okay.
And it has to be complete 6 months. We cannot leave it in between and restart again.
And one important message for all those young women, especially if they had a pulmonary TB around the time of their menarche, there is very likely that they might have got affected. So instead of waiting for a very long time to know whether the TB has affected their genital organs and all, it's better they get evaluated and find out soon after marriage whether actual pulmonary TB in the past has affected them.
Okay. Any sort of addictions will hamper their success rates? Smoking, all.
There was a time when we used to ask the history
husbands.
Of habits from husbands, but
now
we cannot. We have to ask the wife also, because recently there was this couple who was 38 years and 40 years. Then they have undergone IVF and she has failed. So I was asking the husband what kind of habits you have. Then he told I smoke one packet of cigarettes per day and it's been happening since the time of 12 years. Then I noted down. Then I was just explaining him about the effect of smoking on fertility. Then after some time, wife is like, oh, doctor, in that case, I do have also smoking history. And I smoke around 5 cigarettes per day and we've been smoking since the time of college. So will that affect? I said, definitely.
I know.
So it is not those, the timing has changed now. We cannot ask the history of habits only from the husband. We have to ask from the females also. And definitely smoking impacts the fertility potential of the couple.
Ovarian reserve,
egg quality,
implantation,
the sperm, DNA, everything can be affected.
They have a higher risk of developing complications during pregnancy, like PIH, all those things and all. And alcoholism is another thing which is quite rampant.
Okay.
So quite often they don't tell. When we do their LFTs, we incidentally find SGOT-PT being raised.
Okay.
So it's very important that habits has to be asked when we are...
I remember I had a session and there's a room provided for smoking. It was completely filled with girls. Their boyfriends were waiting outside. So as you said, the times are changing. We have to change our questions.
Wishes.
Yeah. And Many people ask me, what does this sperm washing mean? So how does it help in their IUI conception, and what does this sperm washing mean, and does it have a bearing on our IUI success rates?
So ma'am, in IUI, what we will be doing is we are transferring the semen directly into the uterus. Yeah. So we have to remove all the prostaglandins which are there.
Correct.
In order to prevent uterine cramping and pain and all. So these processing techniques, there is commonly we use DG method and swim up method. Mm. So it removes all these excess of infections or prostaglandins, these kinds of secretions from
yes.
the semen.
Mm.
So the concentrate of sperm which will be obtained, which will be high on count and motility, is inseminated into the uterus. So sperm processing techniques play a crucial role
mm.
because we have to select the proper technique depending on how the sample is.
Mm.
Generally, if the sample is very good and count motility is good, we go for a swim-up technique. Or if a borderline sample or a poor motile sperms are less or so, we go with DG method.
Okay.
So that the concentrate of sperms are transferred.
Okay.
Yes, also we have to take into account the how many sperms are having normal forms. So if the sperm is having normal forms of more than 4%, then we can even go for a swim up technique. But if it's the normal forms of sperms are less, then we better to go for a DG, which is the density gradient method.
Okay. Dr. Sophia, will this diabetes, thyroid and other comorbid conditions like any psychiatric illness or if they are on some chronic medications, will all this affect your...
Definitely, ma'am. It will affect the sperms as well as the egg quality. For any women to conceive, we always want the sugar to be, if it's a known case of diabetes, we always want the sugar to be well controlled before
yeah.
she conceives. Not only for the part of pregnancy, but because after pregnancy, we have seen that if the mother is having uncontrolled sugar, there are high chance of congenital heart problem in the child.
Yeah.
So we want the sugar to be controlled that before she plans for pregnancy. Coming to the male part, yes, we have seen that if the male is having uncontrolled diabetes,
yes.
we have lot of infections in the sperm
yeah.
and the number of normal forms are less. And if we go and do the DFI of these sperms, the DFI
high.
Will be definitely high. So such category of patients will definitely have lesser chance of conception with IUI. And also you were telling other
thyroid.
So thyroid hormone also, especially subclinical hypothyroid,
yeah,
wherein the patient doesn't have any symptoms of thyroid problem, but blood test wise, it's not normal.
Mm.
So such couples, such females especially, they have higher chance of abortions. And have difficulty in conception also.
Okay.
So routinely we have to check for hormones like thyroid and prolactin
mm.
in the females.
And they should not stop their medications
yes.
on their own,
yes.
isn't it? Usually girls stop their medications, thyroid medications, and they come with high TSH.
Yes.
That also affects their implantation.
And also many times we have seen that the patient has been put on thyroid tablets
yeah.
and they don't monitor.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. Continuously they'll be taking that high dosage of thyroid without checking what is the level of thyroid.
Mm.
So many times we have seen that iatrogenic fall in the thyroid level because of the high dosage. So once you are on thyroid tablet, we always advise the couple to continuously monitor the thyroid so that we can adjust the thyronorm dosage according to the latest TSH.
Yeah. Dr. Chaitra, I see that if the semen preparation is done in very mediocre labs,
mm.
and in the hands of a bad technician, will we be transferring infection into their uterus? Will it be more grave for them later on?
So actually, one important thing about sperm processing is to remove all the infections, prostaglandins
yeah.
and all. And in case if this is not done properly, there is a chance that whatever infection, especially sexually transmitted diseases also, it can be easily prevented. Transmission can be easily prevented by these. So any sort of sperm preparation technique, when properly done, definitely removes 99% of all diseases, HIV or hepatitis B.
Mm.
So all sorts of sexually transmitted diseases.
Mm.
So it's important that processing techniques to remove these kind of sexually transmitted diseases has to be done.
Okay. Doctor, we see so many people, they have these, before their marriage, they conceive and have these abortions, take tablets. Will all these affect their future fertility?
Yes, ma'am. Many a times we have seen that patients who have had history of abortions, we have seen that tubes are blocked.
Yeah.
It can be because of the infection which has happened during the time of abortion, or any, you know, some the product of conception was not properly cleared out. So many a times we have seen that either there is mild category of endometritis with them, or the tubes being blocked with history of tuberculosis, history of previous abortions.
So, in case if there is history of DNCs, they overtly cure it and damage the basal endometrium. So that's again, they come back with infertilities later.
Okay. So any final word you want to tell our people about the...
So IUI, especially when proper selection is the main criteria for the success rates, and it is best done in a fertility center where we have proper setup for IUI processing, because it requires a very sterile environment and processing has to be done by a technician who is trained. Then only we can try to maximize success rates, keeping in mind everything, the stimulation, the timing of triggering, and then the luteal phase support.
Doctor? I would say that even though the overall success rate of IUI is low, don't get disheartened, because even if in one cycle, if you conceive, your success rate is 100, right? Mm-hmm. So you, if and in the first cycle, if you are not able to conceive, that's not the end. You can try IUI cycles up to a maximum trial of 3 to 4 cycles if your age is young and you don't have any other major pathology. So you can try, give yourself a time of 2 to 3 cycles, and then you can go forward.
And we have seen many people doing 6, 10, 12 cycles of IUI. As Dr. Sophia told, the person who is not able to conceive when properly chosen by 4 cycles, their chances in 5th cycle is almost nil. So better is to give a best trial in a say, IVF center for probably 3 to 4 cycles, and that should be done.
That was very informative, Doctor.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. So we had everything about IUI by our experts today. How many cycles to go with the IUIs, where to get it done. If you are doing your IUIs in the best of setup with the best of the doctors and in the best of the lab setup, you will have a maximum success rates with your IUI. And all about the complications, why it fails and the reasons for it. Thank you so much.